Hello everybody, welcome back yet again to the Guided Dreams YouTube channel. My name is Dr. C.T. Onyema from the Guided Dreams team here in Ontario, Canada. It's an exciting edition because this topic, known as the Canada Express Entry 2024, even as way back as 2023, when I conducted several webinars to teach people on how to migrate to Canada, this is the most interesting topic that, and also most difficult topic that I've been able to, you know, handle. So it's been on my mind on how to simplify this issue about Canada Express Entry pathway, because you agree with me that this is a very, very, very deep pathway to migrating to Canada as a permanent resident. So I'll try as much as I can to simplify everything you need to know about the Canada Express Entry 2024. It might be a long video, but at the end of the day, maybe I'll break it into series. We'll have to have maybe two or three series, shorter videos, you know, to be able to capture everything we need to do. Okay, so welcome back yet again to another exciting edition. Without wasting much of our time, let's deep down into this topic known as the Canada Express Entry 2024. This is your ultimate guide because I'm very sure, I'm confident, I can put my money on the table that this is the best guided video you will see out there. And it's gonna be an explicit breakdown of everything you need to know about Canada Express Entry pathway to migrating to Canada as a permanent resident. I'll share my personal experience. I will equally tell you about how to, you know, package your document right, things you need to get in place, even the, you know, the three categories that we'll have in this platform, the three categories that we'll have in this pathway, the differences between the three of them, what and what you need in terms of education, in terms of your language abilities, in terms of adaptability, in terms of age, several selection factors we are going to be looking at as we move on in this topic, even those, you know, that require a boost in their score, because, you know, this is all about a scoring system. I'm going to share with you how you can be able to boost your score. Without saying so much, I'm excited, you know, to bring this on board to you. Okay, so let's get into this deeply. Okay, now when we talk about the express entry, we are talking about a pathway that, you know, simply manages and oversees three simple categories. Okay, so the express entry is simply an application system that manages three simple categories. The first one is the one they call the, you know, the Federal Skilled Worker Program, or the FSWP. Second one is the Canadian Experience Class, and the third one is the Federal Skilled Trades Program. Now, as we move on, I will tell you the differences between these three categories, those that are covered and those that are not covered. Okay, so when you talk about the Express Entry, simply candidates in the Express Entry pool, they are evaluated based on what you call the human capital factors, such as your work experience, your occupation, your language ability, your education, and age as well. So these are the several factors that you are evaluated upon and assessed for permanent residency here in Canada. Now, as a background, there are six other new categories of the Express Entry. This category, I think sometime in May, if I'm not mistaken, in May 31st, 2023, these six categories, you know, were introduced. And these categories were introduced in order to help, you know, to cushion the effect of Canada's labor force shortage, as well as promote the French language outside of Quebec. Because as you very well know, that Quebec is one of the provinces in Canada that, you know, the French language is of utmost importance. So what are these six new categories of the Express Entry? Now, the first one there is the healthcare. Oh, of course, that is, you know, that's why you see this picture right here, you know, where you see the healthcare crisis. So they require professionals in the healthcare sector to come in. So the second one is what you call this STEM, which simply stands for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Those in this profession, they are also, you know, put in not really a separate pool. Everybody is the same pool. Everybody is in the same pool rather. But over time, IRSC draws people from these specific occupation based on the, you know, labor market impact assessments. Okay. The third one is those in the trades, such as, you know, the carpenters, the plumbers, contractors, and what have you. And the fourth one is those in the transport industry, talking about those in the trucking business and things like that. The fifth one is, you know, agriculture and agri-food, whereas the last but not the least is those that possess strong French language proficiency, which is very, very important, because I'll tell you, as we go deeply into this discussion, I'll tell you the effect of having, you know, French even as your second language. Yeah, it's going to boost your score a whole lot. But as we move on in this discussion, we'll be able to touch these factors. Okay, so what are the minimum requirements for, you know, the Express Entry pathway? You, because as a matter of fact, of course, you must meet all the minimum requirements to be eligible. Okay, so in the next few slides, we are going to take these requirements one by one. But in a nutshell, we have three of them. You have, in general, three minimum requirements you must meet. So you must have a skilled work experience. That is number one. You have the skilled work experience. Number two, your language ability, wherein we'll talk about your ability to communicate in English or French. Then the third one, you must be educated. Now, if you remember those three categories I talked about, the federal skilled worker, federal skilled trade, and the Canadian experience, you know, they have these minimum requirements across all of them, but the points or the level will differ from one category to the other. So, like I said, in the next few slides, we are going to take these requirements one by one and dissect them so that you understand what is required for each requirement, actually, what is required for each requirement, but you get what I mean. So what is required for, you know, each criterion, so that you can be able to, you know, position yourself all right. So what we'll take up the first one, which is called the skilled worker experience. You know, okay. So what do we mean by the skilled worker experience? Then when you discuss the skilled worker experience, you are simply, you know, talking about those with skilled work experience, definitely in NOC tier category 0, 1, 2, or 3. Okay, so these are specific of these categories of professions that are very important and suited for this federal skilled worker program. Now, you must show that actually while you are working in these primary occupations, you perform those duties. Now, when you get to the NOC classification and their duties and responsibilities, make sure that whichever occupation you are choosing as your primary occupation, now, any occupation I'm choosing as my first, as my main occupation when applying for this Express Entry is known as my primary occupation. Okay, let's say for example, I have as a lecturer my NOC, I guess it should be, I can't remember now, I think it's either 0 or 1. I can't remember where the lecturers fall into. But let's say for example, my NOC is NOC 001. And I'm required as a lecturer to be able to you know, career research, guide students and things like that. If, for example, carrying out research in my field and making publications, let's use these two responsibilities, okay? Now, if these two responsibilities are listed in my NOC, I must be sure that when I'm presenting myself as a lecturer, that my work experience covered these two points. That is talking about carrying out research and making publications. I repeat, if your duty, take for example, as a lecturer, is to carry out research and make publications, and these duties are itemized under the NOC responsibilities, okay, make sure that when you are positioning your work experience, that your, even your employment letter as well, because here in Canada, your employment letter will itemize your role and responsibility. So it's expected that your employment letter you are bringing in must show that you did or you are currently doing these two responsibilities. You are carrying out these two responsibilities, talking about the carrying out of research and making publications. Okay. Another example, assuming you are working in as a social worker in a community center, and your responsibility is to administer drugs to your clients as a, when do you take them to games and things like that. This will be itemized in the or NOC essential duties and main duties. So make sure that the employment letter you are positioning will always also list those things. So it's advisable that you go and check your NOC, the responsibilities, even the list statements and things like that, and make sure that they are in line with your work experience as well. I hope this makes sense. So that is in a nutshell what you talk about and what we mean under the skilled work experience. So another important point, you should also must be able to be in the same type of job, like I've explained, within the last 10 years, not 3 years, within the last 10 years. You must as well have done those responsibilities within the last year, last 10 years. Now, another thing I must say at this point is that some people you volunteered, okay, or you undertook unpaid internships. Now, those experiences do not count. Volunteer work and unpaid internship. If your internship was paid for, then they count. But once it's unpaid, you volunteered somewhere, those do not count as work experiences under this scheme. Okay? So your paid work experience must at least be continuous for 1 year, total of 30 hours per week. Okay, so I'll try to put in the link to the NOC website so that you'll be able to search based on your job title, your NOC, and the duties as well. Okay, but all this is about NOC should not bug your head. Don't worry about it now. As we move on, you'll be able to understand a whole lot better. Okay, so if we move on, ways to meet the skilled work experience. Let's take these two clear examples. One is full-time work experience, one is part-time. Now, for you to qualify for this, your target is to have worked 1,560 hours in a whole year. Meaning that assuming you are working not less than 30 hours per week, you need just 12 months. So in a whole year, if you work not less than 30, here in Canada, we'll work 40 hours a week, 8 hours a day times 5 days, that's minimum. Okay, that's 40 hours. So if you've done 30 hours a week in the last 1 year, you should have amassed 1,560 hours in a year for full time. Now, if you are doing part time as well, you can work more or less than 15 hours per week. as long as at the end of the day it adds up to 15, 60 hours. Okay, you can do even two different kind of part-time jobs, to be able to, but make sure that those two part-time jobs are also in line with the NOC you are coming in through. I can't overemphasize this. Your NOC must tally with your work experience, please. Now, if you also want as a part-time work, if you do 15 hours, then that means 24 months is required, because you doing 30 hours a week will just give you 12 months to get 1560 hours a year. But if you're doing half of that, so that means 2 years. Okay, any hours above 30 hours per week does not count. Like I said before, volunteering work and unpaid internships as well do not count. Okay, now work experience you gain while you are studying towards your minimum may count. Work experience you gained while you are studying will count towards your minimum requirements if the work was paid, either by wages or by commissions, and there was a continuity. There's no gap in employment, okay? And as well as you have met all other requirements of the program, okay? So, excuse me. So, like I said, a full list of the National Occupational Classification, that is what we call the NOC, will be in this video's description. So moving ahead, we have talked about the, you know, skilled work experience and things you need to do. That is number one. Number two, remember we have talked about the first one, which is the skilled work experience. Now the second one is your language ability, and we have a third one, which is your education. Now talking about the language abilities, there are two ways you can show your language ability, either in English or in French. Okay, it's either you show in English or you show in French. Now, if you're taking the IELTS, you have four bands, talking about the writing, reading, listening, and speaking. Now, it's required that you have a minimum of 7 CLB. Okay, now, for IELTS, you can take IELTS and CELPIP. Those in Canada, you take CELPIP. Those all over the world, you can take IELTS because it's global. But remember, please, that your language test must not be more than 2 years old from the date of the test result. And it should also be valid even until the day you apply for your permanent resident. Okay? Now, for the Federal Skill Worker Program, your minimum is CLB Band 7. For the Federal Skill Trade Program, your minimum is 5 for speaking and listening and 4 for reading and writing. So these are, you know, the little differences between these two. But we'll learn about this even as we move on further. So the third and last requirement there is your education. Definitely, you should have your certificate or a diploma or a degree. They're required to be Canadian equivalent. Now, if you're studying in Canada, you don't need to do any assessment of your credential. But if you study outside Canada, you must show that your certificate is equivalent to the Canadian. If you got a diploma from outside Canada, you must assess it to show that it's also equivalent to a diploma gotten in Canada. So what do you do? You go and do what you call the educational credential assessment for immigration purposes. Normally the WES is the popular one that does the assessment. There are other organizations that are acceptable, but commonly people use WES. I use WES, so it's easy and straightforward. Okay, so that is the third and final minimum requirements you must meet. So recall, the first one is what? Skilled work experience, if you say that you are right. The second one is your language ability. Then the last one is your what? Education. Okay. Now, what are the selection factors? Assuming I got all these three minimum requirements, I've checked my skilled experience. I have 1 year of ex at least 1 year of experience in the right NOC, my language ability, I've done my test, and the third one, my keep forgetting this, my education as well is on point, and I've done my credential assessment. Now, how else will I be selected? So that will lead us to the topic when we say what are the minimum what are the selection factors? Now, there is a minimum requirement you must meet. Okay, and once you've met that, they will assess you based on other factors, which you call the selection factors. So even though your education is on point, your language is on point, your skilled work experience is on point, you will also have to gain some points based on other factors. Now, the overall score you would should get for you to pass is at least 64. Okay, now these points are collated and they amount to 100 points, but the minimum you should get for you to be able to be moved from just being an applicant into the pool is 67. Now, what are these selection points? One of them is your age. Age has its own point. I will show you a breakdown of all these, how many points they will give you, given your age, your education, your work experience. I will show you that even your, if you have a valid job offer as well, and your English or French language skills. Okay, your adaptability as well. So these are the six selection points or six selection factors, if you wish to call it that, that you will be further assessed and your score will be rated over what, 100. And remember, the minimum for you to join the pool is 67 points. Now, what happens if you get that 67 points? If you're assessed and you have 67 points, what happens? Now, look at this. You do what? You jump into the express entry pool. You jump into the pool. Now, on the other side, I remember if you take a look at this picture, you will clearly see that you are not alone in the pool. Some people are dipping in with their legs, some are diving in, some are hopping in, like the lady there. So it stands for so many things. So many people are coming in with different amount of scores. And once you get into that pool, you are reassessed again. I will show you that overall, and you are rated out of 1200 points. I will show you. Now let's see the other side. Assuming you have less than 67, what happens? You may be able to get a higher score by doing a few of these things: improving your language skills, completing another degree, diploma, or certificate, or receiving an offer from a Canadian employer. Okay, these are ways you can do to improve your score to be eligible. Okay, so another very important thing we need to talk about is what you call the proof of funds. So let's say you've gotten your skilled work experience right, you've gotten your language ability right, you've gotten your education right, and using those six selection factors, you've been drafted into the pool and you've ranked high and you've been invited to apply, what you would call invitation to apply. So subsequently in this video, I'll just be using ITA. Now, another strong thing you need to show is what you call the proof of funds. Now, you must be able to show that you have enough money for you and your family to settle in Canada. Now, there are two conditions where you do not require to show proof of fund. One is if you are already legally working in Canada, maybe as international students or postdoctorate degree programs, you're already working and you are earning in Canada. If you are applying, as a matter of fact, your class should be Canadian experience class, not just the federal skilled worker class. But we'll get into those details, because once you get into the pool, you don't get to select which one you're being invited for. IRCC will evaluate you against the three of them and invite you to apply through a particular means. But we'll get into those juicy details as we move along. So the second time when you do not require proof of fund is if you have a valid job offer from an employer in Canada. So if you are not working in Canada already legally, or you don't have a valid job offer, then you must have a proof of fund. So what is this figure? So this is a figure I got from the IRCC website, and this was last updated, I think, in April 25, 2023. Now, if you are single, and you are definitely single, not married, now you should show this figure, which is 13,757, as a proof of fund. And these figures are in Canadian dollars. Okay. Now, if you are married and you have one child, your proof of fund should be 21,055. Okay. If you are above, maybe your number of family members are above seven. For anybody, any extra person after that seventh person, make sure you're adding $3,706 on top of the last figure you have there. Okay, so these are the proof of funds you should show to the officers once you apply, as a once you respond to that invitation to apply to come as a permanent resident in Canada. Now, these numbers are updated every year based on 50% of the low income cutoff totals. Okay, so definitely you have to do a research of how much it will cost you to live and settle in any of the provinces, okay, that you are aspiring to settle in Canada. As a matter of fact, some provinces are a lot cheaper than others. Take, for example, Ontario versus Manitoba. Ontario is more expensive than Manitoba. But in terms of maybe jobs and opportunities, depending on your line of career, you could say Ontario is better than Manitoba. So things like that. Do your own research. Speak to people. Talk to friends. Bring as much money as you can. There can never be a situation where you say you have too much money not to, you know, leave some and come. No, bring as much money as you can. This will help you, you know, to be able to settle easily in Canada. But remember, if you are coming to Canada with more than $10,000 in cash, remember, if you are coming into Canada with more than $10,000 in cash, you must declare that at the airport. Another important point, but to me this is not much of a problem, is what you call admissibility. Not everybody is admissible into Canada. For example, if you have a serious disease or if you have any criminal case against you, bear in mind one of the documents you are going to submit is what you call the police certificate. Some people call it police clearance certificate from any country you've lived in, okay, for the past 10 years. You're going to go get a police clearance certificate from them. Another point there is you're not a security threat to Canada. Okay. Now, where you can live in Canada as a permanent resident, you can live anywhere. As a skilled worker, you can live anywhere except in Quebec. And this is very simple. This is because Quebec has their own way of getting their own permanent residency candidates. So they are not covered. They are different. Okay. The province of Quebec selects its own skilled workers. So if you are planning on living in Quebec, you can do well to see what you call the Quebec selected skilled workers. Okay. I'll try to put in the details for that. But remember, for you to qualify in Quebec, this beautiful city you are seeing here, you need to at least be able to communicate in French, to be able to navigate clearly, or easily, I should say, the society in Quebec. But that's not compulsory. But if you know how to speak French, Quebec is your go-bet. They're going to embrace you speedily. Now, when you fill out your profile, you'll be asked where you plan to live in Canada. It doesn't mean that that is where you must stay. The only people that must stay in wherever they put in is people that are coming in through the provincial nomination program. We'll get to that later. Maybe not in this video, but subsequent videos, okay? Now, like I said before, you do not need to settle in that province, except you are coming into the provincial nominee program that nominated you. Then you must live in that province, I think, for, is it 3 years? Some provinces, they differ. Some provinces will tell you to that you must stay in their province for 3 years before you can leave. Some will say you can stay 15 months, then you can leave. Some will say you can come, I think in New Brunswick, you can come in, and if you can prove that you don't have a job for the next 2 or 3 months, then you have a ground to leave. So each of the provinces, they have their own way of assessing people, but bear in mind that you have to state where you want to live, okay? But that doesn't mean you must stay there. Does that make sense? Okay, give us a thumbs up, a like, a comment, and don't forget to subscribe.